Thanks. Thank you, Helen, for inviting me to come and talk at this event today. So, I'm Nick from the Pesticide Action Network, and as the name suggests, our focus is on pesticides and what they do, and trying to stop the harm that they do to the environment and to human health. You heard a lot about REACH just now. Well, pesticides aren't regulated under REACH, they're regulated under their very own special regulation, and actually, we're probably facing, depending on what day of the week it is, I'm either optimistic or pessimistic, but we are potentially facing a much more dire situation with pesticides than we are perhaps with other chemical regulation. So what are pesticides and why are we concerned? Well, pesticides are poisons. That's their job, that's what they're designed to do. They're designed to kill living organisms, and they do that incredibly effectively. They don't just kill the things that they're targeted at, they have effects on non-target organisms, including people. And many of the pesticides that are made have, they're poisons, they're designed to kill things, they have intrinsically hazardous properties. This is not just us saying them, this is from the toxicological testing that the manufacturers make. So they know they're introducing carcinogens into the environment, they know that they're introducing endocrine disrupting chemicals into the environment. It's done on purpose and for a reason. So what is an endocrine disrupting chemical? They're substances that interfere with our hormones, the hormone system. In particular, they can interfere in negative ways with growth and reproductive functions. In women, some of the outcomes could be decreased fertility, ovarian cysts, complications in pregnancy, and breast cancer, I'll link to those. In men, again, decreased fertility, genital malformations, testicular and prostate cancer, And then the non-gender-specific health outcomes can be neurological disorders, Parkinson's, and a whole range of other cancers. And they are known to cause these. Which is why we regulate them, or why we try and regulate them, or why they should be regulated. They're everywhere. As you've heard, the whole list of things that they turn up in, they are particularly prevalent in pesticides. And there are some real issues with particularly endocrine disrupting chemicals that are turning science on its head. The old paradigm of the dose makes the poison has been thrown out with endocrine disruptors. A growing body of research and evidence is showing that actually really, really small doses, really tiny exposures to endocrine disrupting chemicals can have a much greater effect than the higher doses, which is how we regulate currently. Find a safe level, but a level a bit higher than that, that should be fine. It's not the case with endocrine disrupting chemicals, and it's changing things. Likewise, we don't regulate against the cocktail effect. So every day we're in contact with thousands and thousands of chemicals potentially affecting our health. There is very little research done on how these chemicals interact, the synergies between them, how the effects of them can be increased by working a combinatory effect. And the regulatory system certainly doesn't take any kind of notice of that. However, we do have some regulation, and it comes from the EU. And while it's not perfect, and for this I'm not talking about REACH, I'll leave that to others to talk about, that's not my area. But on pesticide regulation, the EU, again, it's not perfect, but it is probably the best in the world. It has moved towards a more hazard-based approach to pesticide regulation, wherein something that is intrinsically hazardous.
Speak up, I'm not sure that everybody can hear. I don't know how these mics, where we can turn up the mics.
I can move closer, is that any better?
You can't get any nearer.
Not that, don't move that one.
No? Oh, sorry, would you?
All right, I'll shout out a little bit. Is that better?
Yes.
Excellent, brilliant. So if you missed all that, I'm sorry, but it's all on tape, so you can catch up with it later on. So yes, the EU provides a regulatory system that is not perfect, but is probably the best in the world for pesticides. It is, loosely speaking, hazard-based, which means that if a pesticide is deemed to have an intrinsically hazardous nature, i.e. it's a carcinogen, a reprotoxin, bioaccumulative, harmful to the environment, then it cannot be used and it should be substituted for something less harmful. Within that regulation, one of the criteria is on endocrine disrupting chemicals. At the time of the regulation, they hadn't actually decided what constituted an endocrine disruptor, which was a little oversight. And several years later, the European Commission put up what they thought should be classified as endocrine disrupting chemicals within the world of pesticides. And it was, frankly, it wasn't up to scratch. And the reason being that the vested interests in the pesticide industry, the pesticide manufacturers, the national farmers, and most of the opposition was from the UK, I hasten to add, some from Germany as well. The National Farmers Union, DEFRA, various other government departments and their supporters all lobbied to have a really weak definition of what an endocrine disruptor is. They'd also lobbied tooth and nail to try and not get this regulation in the first place, and they continue to do so. But nonetheless, it is going forward, and it is quite progressive. To get back to the point of what Helen was talking about reach, what happens when we leave the EU? Well, nobody knows about anything. I mean, not just pesticides, but actually nobody knows about what happens when we leave the EU in regard to every aspect of life. But on pesticides, I can tell you, pesticide manufacturers, who are incredibly powerful, the National Farmers Union, who are incredibly powerful in what they do in terms of advising government policy on agriculture, are rubbing their hands in glee at the thought that we can do away with the over-precautionary, ridiculously green legislation from Europe. They are rubbing their hands at the thought that they can reintroduce pesticides that have been banned on human health or environmental grounds, and we face a real, real risk of a race to deregulate pesticides, which has consequences for all of us. So pesticides, you know, are linked to breast cancer as endocrine disruptors, but as in carcinogens in their own right. They're linked to a whole range of different cancers. The most recent debate about glyphosate has shown it to be a probable human carcinogen with links to non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, various other things. And there are some groups, so where are pesticides seen? Well, they are everywhere. They're not just in agriculture. You don't have to live next to a farm to be exposed to pesticides. They're in every single person in this room. DDT, which was banned in the UK over 30 years ago, is within every single one of us. It's within children who were born after it was banned, who have never been anywhere near it. We are riddled with pesticides, all of us. It's in our water, it's in our soil, it's in the air, and it's in the food that we eat. It's sprayed in our towns. There are 41 different pesticides used on the streets and pavements, the schools, hospitals, parks and playgrounds, where we and our children live, work and play. 41 different types. Just looking at the top 15 most frequently used in towns and cities, 6 of them are suspected endocrine disruptors, 13 of them are known possible or probable human carcinogens. And then when we move on to food, it gets even more alarming. Well, our report was mentioned earlier. We looked at the pesticide residue results for the fruit and vegetables supplied under the Department of Health's School Fruit and Vegetable Scheme. And the scheme has a very noble ambition, and that's to supply every 4 to 6 year old at school in England with one piece of fruit or veg every day to encourage healthy eating habits going forward and taking that forward into later life with them. And I applaud that, that's fantastic. But we looked at the pesticide residue levels in there. None of the food produced and provided was organic, which would have meant there were no pesticide residues present. There are only 8 different types of fruit and veg, so we're not talking about the whole range of everything that we eat that's available. We found 123 different pesticides across that range of fruit and veg. 43 of those were suspected endocrine disruptors, and 52 were known possible or probable carcinogens. And we're feeding this to 4 and 6 year olds who are one of, if not the most vulnerable group to the long-term effects, the chronic health effects of exposure to pesticides, endocrine disrupting chemicals. We also found out that for a penny per child per day, all of that could be provided organically, all of it. And it brings me on to what should the government be doing? What the government shouldn't be doing is listening to the people that make and profit from these poisons, which is their default setting at the moment. That is what they should not be doing. They should not be deregulating. What they should be doing is protecting us and the environment from the effects of these chemicals. That is their job, and they are being negligent. To come back to the school fruit and vegetable scheme reports, well, we've been for many years trying to get the Department of Health interested in pesticides and the health effects of pesticides, and looking at, well, maybe if we stopped using so many carcinogens or endocrine disruptors, reprotoxins and these other things, maybe if we stopped them, we could actually prevent some of the health outcomes that they come from. So we sent our report to them. We sent our report to Jeremy Hunt, and one of his under ministers came back and said, pesticides, not our remit. Frankly, that is disgraceful, but it's been long held. So one of the things we are trying to do, and we need help in perhaps building a coalition to do so, is to get the Department of Health, to get the Health Minister, interested in pesticides as a way of preventing diseases. A report from the European Parliament showed that the health costs of pesticide-related ill health are in the billions. So if we had a simple strategy of reducing them, you know, we could save money. The other thing we want to do, and we want to get in as part of the Brexit thing, we want it to get written into the proposed 25-year environmental plan. We want to get it written into the agriculture bill, and we want to get a commitment from the government, is for them to set a quantitative, time-based reduction target. We would like, it's open to discussion how that looked. France, years ago under Sarkozy, said, we want to reduce our overall use of pesticides by 50% by 2020. They're getting towards the target. Denmark have done very similar things. France has also banned the use of all non-agricultural pesticides by 2020. We have nothing. We have mealy-mouthed talk about managing them so we can have some acceptable level of risk. I don't think there is an acceptable level of risk for a poisoning a 4 to 6 year old with the food that they eat. I'm sorry. So the government needs to up its game. And Brexit provides an opportunity for us to put pressure on them to do that. Obviously, there's the threat I also already mentioned. But if we do, to go back to Helen's point, all stand up and say, this is what we want our future to look like, perhaps we can make it so. That's me.
What we thought we would do would be just after each of the speakers have spoken, and before we get to a Q&A at the very end, are there any questions that relate particularly to this, thoughts, comments? We thought we'd have a little break after each speaker, if there was anything people wanted to ask, or no, we carry on?
Can you recommend any specific pamphlets or books?
Well, some of them. There's many, many other things on our website as well. So.
Yes. Sorry, hang on.
Could you just repeat? So Denmark and France have banned pesticides from
2020? No, they have reduction targets. They have quantitative reduction targets. But France has banned non-agricultural the use of all non-agricultural pesticides. Excuse me. So the things used in towns and cities, or in people's homes and gardens, by 2020. But also set an overall target of a 50% reduction in use across all areas, so mainly in agriculture. You know, and there are other places, so Belgium, all the towns and cities in Belgium are pesticide free by the end of this year. Similar things in the Netherlands, Italy banning glyphosate. You know, there's some very progressive work being done by member states to protect their citizens from the harmful effects of pesticides. But it doesn't happen here.
They are
in public areas, yes.
Yes.
I couldn't hear everything you said. Did you say, you're mentioning these individual countries, France, Belgium, etc. What did you say about European law on pesticides? It presumably lags way behind France and Denmark.
No, in fact, that's what's driving France and Denmark to do things. There is a directive which is not binding that has given some language and framework and ideas that they can.
Non-binding directive.
Yeah, but they can, that they can do, and that's how they've chosen to implement it, whereas the UK has chosen to largely ignore all the things mentioned in it. The thing the EU has done is on approving active substances and looking at their intrinsic properties. The intrinsic properties of each pesticide that's approved for use. That's where it is a lot stronger than elsewhere in the world. And actually, we've phased out some of the worst things. You know, we've got a ban on looming on three of the biggest selling insecticides that are killing bees. So there is. It's far from perfect, but it's the best example that we have at the moment.
Okay, two more. One and then. Imports,
yeah.
Importing.
Do they make sure they ensure that the imports comply with the ban as they're moving forward?
Well, this is another thing. This is an EU-wide thing. So any pesticide that is banned for use within the EU, any produce imported to the EU, cannot have a detectable level of that pesticide on it. Otherwise, it will be refused. And that's another interesting issue about how we go forward with Brexit. It's a positive thing. So if UK farmers who currently do most of their business with the EU want to sell to the EU, they can't have detectable levels of banned pesticides on them. So in effect, we hope that will influence some of the approach. But again, that will change what we can import, so we could then start importing things with residues of banned pesticides on from elsewhere. That would be fine if we're sat outside of the EU. So again, it's a risk opportunity type situation.
Yes.
Well, it's similar. It is similar to the REACH thing. You know, we would like to run parallel, take our decisions based on what happens in Brussels, really. Again, we don't have the capacity, we don't have the money to set up these bodies effectively, certainly not in the short term. So, you know, from a purely financial point of view, sticking with what the EU does is the most sensible, and that's what we're calling for. But the one thing we really want to see is a commitment to pesticide reduction in the UK. That's the driver that everything else can hang off. That would be the focal point for people to actually start. Because at the moment there is nothing. We must do this. We should do that. There's nothing to focus on getting to a way. So we need something to hang a future pesticide strategy in the UK off, and that really is it.
Okay.